Today's podcast is brought to you by WarbyParker.com. Get a free 5-day home try-on at WarbyParkerTrial.com/David Feldman Show. 5 pairs, 5 days, 100% free.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
J. Elvis Weinstein is one of the founding members of Mystery Science Theater 3000 or 2000?
It was 3000.
3000. And was a writer, producer on Freaks and Geeks. And he is a documentarian. Besides being a great comedian and comedy writer, he's a director. His new movie is I Need You to Kill. Welcome to our show, J. Elvis Weinstein.
Very happy to be here. Thanks.
You're joining us from the Valley.
From beautiful Sherman Oaks, California.
Yes, and we're in beautiful New York City. I saw you last week while I was in L.A. And tell me about I Need You to Kill. What is this documentary about? It sounds fascinating.
This documentary is about the burgeoning stand-up scene in Asia. Sort of told through the eyes of three American headliners who are brought over there by a club owner named Louis Lee, who runs a club called Acme Comedy Company in Minneapolis, which is a great stand-up club.
Oh yeah, I love
one of the great clubs.
Oh, it's and he is one of the great human beings. Go ahead.
Absolutely, and he says hello because I just talked to him.
Tell him I said hello. Tell him I love him.
Yeah, he's a beloved guy, and I've known him literally since I was a 16-year-old middle. At a club called the Comedy Gallery, and he was the bar manager. So I've known him for almost 30 years, and watched him grow his club from a bad place to one of the best. You know,
he had a fascination with political satirists because he came from Hong Kong, where to this day freedom of speech is, some would say, non-existent.
Well, it exists in the stand-up world, and I don't know if that's because of the lack of it being on the radar yet, or if they're still flexing the last vestiges of British Hong Kong.
Right. I mean, speech in China is being restricted.
Yes.
And our internet companies here in America are complicit in that. In order to do business with China, they'll censor. The myth that capitalism would bring freedom to China is a myth. So the movie, you directed this movie, and it follows comedians performing in Asia. Which specific countries were they again?
They went to Hong Kong, Singapore, and Macau.
So Macau is an island off mainland China, correct?
Yes.
It's like a gambling place, right?
It's basically China's Vegas now.
But it's bigger than Vegas.
It's bigger, yeah. It was a Portuguese colony for about 200 years, and it was handed back to China, much like Hong Kong was around the same time. So it's still under that same 50-year... separate, but, the two system, one country, two system thing.
So you have comics. Who are the comics who made this journey?
Tom Segura.
Mm-hmm.
Chad Daniels and Pete Lee.
I don't know Pete Lee. Is he Asian?
He's not, which he got mileage out of on the trip.
Okay.
Chad and Pete are both, Pete is in New York. He's been out there for several years, but Chad and Pete were both Acme sort of homegrown from open stager, now headliner guys. And Tom Segura is just a funny dude.
Okay. So now you have four funny guys traveling in China. How long did it take before this conversation sprouted? We better make sure they only serve Pepsi if there's a Chinese comic opening for us.
I didn't get it on camera if it happened.
No, seriously. At what point did you see, you know, a glass of Coke and make the joke?
I don't even know the joke.
Oh, come on, J. Elvis.
I don't. You're making me feel like an amateur now.
Are you kidding? I cannot believe you guys traveled throughout China.
Yeah.
Telling jokes. And the subject of a glass of Coke never came up?
Is this the something pee-pee in my Coke?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm not saying that the jokes weren't equally juvenile and or racist throughout the trip, but we just didn't get to that one.
How could you not get... I oh, my God. So, okay. Now I can talk, because I was hanging on to that for so long. And
I'm sorry.
Yeah, so now I can actually focus.
We can excise that from your show.
No. I want to keep it in. It was like a popcorn kernel stuck in my back molar, and it's been it's been flossed out. And let's get back to the documentary. When did you shoot the documentary?
In the fall of 14.
And how long is it?
How long is the doc?
Yeah.
It's 97 minutes, I think.
It was shot on what? Not iPhones, right?
No, we shot with Canon C100 digital high-def cameras.
And you directed this? And
I did.
And when?
I took two camera guys and a fully dedicated sound guy, so a crew of three and me.
I Need You to Kill is playing where? How can we see this?
You can't yet. It is just we're just sort of entering the world of commerce with it now. It's like it's a month since finished.
And what is the message to this movie? That comedy is a universal language, or that English is a universal language? Do they do stand-up comedy in Chinese, or is it all done in England, in English?
There are separate scenes. The movie, I'm covering the movie with the English scene. And a lot of the message of it is sort of through Louis Lee's voice, which is twofold, which, you know, his advice to sort of comics is, you know, be true to yourself. You know, the only good comedy comes from you personally. And he's also sort of there trying to shepherd and help the club owners there, because it feels like the 1980s over there right now. You know, it's all, you know, one-nighters in bars and, you know, very few full-time clubs, but there's like crowds coming out for it. And there's, you know, comics who can do 10 minutes, you know, but it has a very distinct feel of that 80s, you know, mid-80s comedy boom here.
You're talking about mainland China?
Even on mainland China, there are several rooms that are now in mainland China, too. I didn't get to them, but they're happening in Shanghai and Beijing. And
are they modeled after, you know, stand-up comedy was invented in America.
Yeah, and all these English-speaking rooms, for the most part, have been started by expats from America or Great Britain or Australia. And most of the comics doing it are expats or people who were Hong Kong natives who went and studied overseas and came back.
Do you have any idea the number of English-speaking people living in China?
I don't in China. In Hong Kong, it's, you know, it's probably 15 or 20% who fully speak English.
Yeah, my son lives in Germany. He's, you know, and the deal with the German government is if you learn German, we'll educate you for free. And he says, you know, he's learning German, but you can live in Germany and not speak a lick of German, and people will speak English with you. English has become the lingua franca.
Absolutely. And in Hong Kong, you totally can get by with English. When I was in Tokyo shooting my previous documentary, it was much more pantomime throughout the day.
Hmm. And what was your previous documentary?
Previous documentary was called Michael J. Barr, Who Do You Want Me to Be? And it's about this rock singer and actor who's had this Zelig-like career from, you know, being one of the kids in To Sir With Love to singing at Live Aid to from WKRP to, you know, to being on Zeppelin's label and, you know, so just this crazy, and he married Pamela DeBar who wrote I'm With The Band. And
he's living, where does he live now?
He lives in the Valley.
Oh.
Here in Los Angeles.
And what is the name of the documentary?
It's called Michael DeBar, Who Do You Want Me To Be?
And where can we see that?
Also on the verge of distribution right now, but working on music issues with it.
Okay, with the Chinese, it is my understanding that the Chinese, or the ancient Chinese, viewed laughter and smiling, the showing of teeth, as submissive. Much the same way my dog, when he smiles, I'm being serious, dog Cody would show his teeth not as an act of aggression, but as a signal that he was being submissive. In the United States, laughter is aggression. We show our teeth to snarl, to exhibit hostility. So is there a different sensibility with the Chinese audience? When they laugh, are they being hostile? Are they being submissive? Do they respond to aggression? Comics who are aggressive, or more of like a Maria Bamford type?
Well, in this case, I had three pretty aggressive comics. It's hard to say they were Chinese audiences. You know, in Hong Kong, it was mostly expats from elsewhere. In Singapore, which is an actual English speaking country, which has, you know, Indian, Chinese, and Malay are their three major ethnicities there, but they all are English speaking. It played very much like a Western country. You know, it felt like very, it was a young comedy scene, definitely very open stagey, but the open stage acts were killing.
And what are the Chinese comics talking about? Do they criticize Xi? Is that exile? How do you pronounce the prime minister?
There's very few. There's only a couple of actual political comics. In Singapore, it's weird because that's a very authoritarian country. And most entertainment is censored. You have to submit scripts to get rated by the editorial board. Stand-up is somehow under the radar still. So, you know, I talked to comics who are going, yeah, there's stuff I'll definitely say on stage that I won't put on my Facebook page, you know. And they're taking, you know, not Bill Hicksian stands, but they're doing naughty jokes about the government, I would say.
So most of them, I would assume, play it safe and talk about sex and going to the bathroom, right?
Yeah, and local stuff, a lot of local stuff, like, you know, like new comics in the United States, you start off with, you know, the stuff that works, you know, the expats in Hong Kong are doing a lot of stuff about Hong Kong and what it's like to live in Hong Kong and white guys with Chinese women jokes, you know. In Singapore, they talk, you know, about Singapore a lot. And they do a lot of racial stuff. A lot of crowd rap, where are you from? Here's a joke about that place.
So is that's interesting. So you make fun of where somebody's from. I do remember W.C. Fields saying, I read a book about W.C. Fields while I was just starting out to do stand-up, and he said he never got over the fact that when he was in vaudeville, no matter where he played, there was always one city that if you mentioned it, the audience would laugh at it. And there was always...
Absolutely. And those universals are completely intact over there.
Wow.
In Hong Kong, they make fun of the mainlanders.
Mm-hmm.
Because the mainlanders, with their massive newfound amounts of cash, you know, stream into Hong Kong to come shop, you know, and are just, you know, so newbie rich that, you know, their representation of rich is like, you know, let's wear three Rolexes, you know.
Is there anything like our politically correct movement? Is there a line that you can cross where the audience self-censors, not the government, where the audience thinks you've crossed the line and they're offended?
It's pretty much at not funny still, you know. That's pretty much, you know, like Chad Daniels does some pretty edgy ass stuff in this thing, and because it's funny, he gets away with it. But lesser comics wouldn't have.
Right,
you know?
And you're talking about playing to expats. But did you see you saw Chinese speaking comics playing to Chinese audiences? Correct.
I saw. Well, no, I didn't. I didn't film any actual Chinese stand-up. Chinese stand-up is a separate scene, and it really is a different form of comedy. It's a much longer storytelling sort of thing. And there are comics there who do both scenes, but they say for the most part their act, you can't just translate your English act into Chinese and have it work.
And these, are they modeled at the Chinese clubs, are they modeled after Yuck Yucks and the Punchline? Do they look and sound like American comedy clubs, or are they?
For the most part, or at least, you know, American one-nighters, you know, and good, you know, decent one-nighters. There's the one full-time club that we went to in Hong Kong is called Takeout Comedy, and it started by a guy named Jamie Gong, who was actually a Chinese-American guy who grew up in Chinatown in New York and went over there and opened this club and started teaching people how to do stand-up and just, you know, doing bad shows and bad shows and bad shows until they got enough comics who could do good sets, you know. But he built his room up that way. He basically went and started a comedy scene there.
And who are the influences?
These days it's guys like Bill Burr and Louis C.K. and, you know, it's such a global, you know, thing now. Dave Chappelle, obviously, I can't think of his name right now, I just blanked on it, but the guy, Indian comic, who's just huge right
Peters.
Now.
Peters.
Yes, Russell Peters. You know, he's a big influence over there, for sure.
So I guess it's YouTube, they're in the internet, and the whole...
Yeah, exactly.
Wow. We're talking with J. Elvis Weinstein. You know him from Mystery Science Theater 3000 and The Edge with Mark Thompson. He's also been a writer, producer on Freaks and Geeks. His new movie is I Need You to Kill, which will be released shortly once we get a distributor. Is that what the plan is?
That's how it's going to happen, yeah.
Yeah. And, of course, Amazon, iTunes, and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
Freaks and Geeks, Judd Apatow.
Yes.
James Franco. Right?
And so many others. Seth Rogen, Jason Segel, Linda Cardellini, Martin Starr.
Why does that show still resonate with people? Is it because of the stars who came out of it, or was it because of the writing and the producing? I say it's because of the writing and the producing.
I think the stars that came out of it are what keeps drawing people to it now. But mm-hmm. I think once you're there, it's a pretty well-made piece of TV.
Did you know it was a well-made piece of TV while you were making it?
Yeah, we all knew. Everyone cared. Every department on the show, you know, was clearly everyone was doing their best, you know, and everyone was excited to be doing it.
Mystery Science 3000, I'm a good friend of Frank Conniff's. He does the show all the time.
It's his birthday today, in fact.
Is it really?
It is.
Oh. I will have to call him. Why does that still resonate? When I saw you in L.A., you said that you had just the right amount of fame from that show. What did you mean by that?
It was when we toured, I got together with Frank and Joel Hodgson and Trace Blue and Mary Jo Peel, you know, three of us were the originals, and then Frank came on when I left the show. But we toured as this thing called Cinematic Titanic, and we did like 1,200 seat theaters around the country for a few years, and it was really fun. But it was like, we were talking the other day, and it was like the perfect amount of fame, because you go and you do this show, and you're totally famous in that theater. And you sign autographs, and then you walk out the door, and you are totally anonymous again.
Mm-hmm.
And so you get to turn it on and off like a faucet, which is, you know, pretty ideal. Unless you need it, you know.
Right.
Then you want the faucet on at all times.
J. Elvis Weinstein is the director of I Need You to Kill. I don't know where it will be playing, but I can assure you you'll be able to catch it on Netflix, Amazon, and iTunes. You can see his work on Mystery Science Theater 3000, Freaks and Geeks. You can listen to him once a week on The Edge. Give us the podcast ID so people can find that.
Go to edge-show.com. And right. It'll, you can either play them there or go to iTunes or Skechers?
Stitchers.
Yeah,
Is it Stitcher? It's Stitcher.
And the iHeartRadio network as well.
Before we go, Gene Wilder passed away.
Heartbreaking.
Yeah. Any thoughts besides heartbreak?
There was just like no one more hilariously riveting than him as a comic actor. I mean, it's just like every role he ever played, you couldn't imagine anyone else playing the role.
Yeah.
You know, he just brought such you know, actual acting chops to every comedy role, you know, that, you know, he stood out just as an actor himself, but just as a person and as a sort of riveting presence, you know. I remember just being sort of, as a kid, my parents took me to Young Frankenstein when I was like 4 years old, which was a huge mistake because I was terrified by it. But I was, and my mom like had to keep taking me out to the lobby, but I kept wanting to go back in because I knew it was funny. Everyone else was laughing. I was terrified.
Mm-hmm.
So, but it was Gene Wilder that I kept wanting to go back and watch more, you know?
Yeah.
And ever since then, including one of my favorite underrated movies, The Frisco Kid.
Oh, I'll have to see that.
Where he plays, a rabbi in the Old West with Harrison Ford.
Oh my God! How did I not know about this?
It's like 1979, and it was on heavy cable rotation when I was like 11. So wow. I became a huge fan of it.
Well, I posted on Facebook. I'll post it to my website. Mel Brooks in 1969 accepting the Academy Award for The Producers.
Uh-huh.
Did you ever see his acceptance speech?
I have. Yeah.
Do you remember how he wrapped it up?
I don't offhand.
Mel Brooks, he beat out 2001. This was back when, I guess, there weren't separate screenplay. You know, best screenplay was best screenplay. And
right.
He said, I'd like to thank Zero Mostel, the people from, you know, the studio. And I'd also like to thank Gene Wilder. That's how Mel accepted his Academy Award. Hey, Elvis Weinstein, come back real soon.
Would love to. I'll be funny next time.
You were hysterical. I Need You to Kill. Coming to a theater or streaming.
Or your phone or some shit.
Yeah. Thank you, buddy.
Thank you.